thinking before every kind of focusing right now in every kind of country. Okay, shall we just replay in there? Are we supposed to replay in there?
this last Sunday of 2023, which, by the way, several have reminded me is 123123, and this afternoon at 1:23 it'll be 123123123. And this first Sunday after Christmas, to celebrate the light that has come into the world, the joy that has come to the earth in the birth of a Savior, the Son of God who makes it possible for us to all be children of God. In this morning's service, one combined service, you'll get a little bit of the 9:30 flavor, a little bit of the 11:30 flavor as we sing and celebrate together. So we stand and sing together, Joy to the World.
Please remain standing for our Christmas liturgy. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel. By the tender mercy of our God, the dawn from on high has broken upon us to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death. For unto us a child is born. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. My eyes have seen your salvation. Saving God, we confess to you our sinfulness. We are consumed with greed and with self, instead of loving you as we ought. Too often we are indifferent to those for whom this season is not a time of joy. You call us to the simple life, but we engage in extravagance, which directs our hearts away from you and from those in need. With Mary, we exalt you, God our Redeemer.
Holy is the Lord.
to you, Lord our God. You have chosen us in Jesus Christ our Lord before the founding of the world.
You have given us such a love, Father, that we should be called Savior.
You have blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. You have redeemed us through Jesus Christ, your incarnate Son. Holy Child of Mary, Savior of the world, by your holy incarnation, by your human birth, by your pure and blameless childhood, by your obedience and diligence, by your humility and meekness and patience, by your extreme poverty, by your griefs and your sorrows, by your prayers and your tears, by your having been despised and rejected, by your cross and suffering, and by your death and burial, by your triumphant resurrection and ascension. For the poor, the abused, and the sick, for the prisoners and the homeless, for victims of natural disaster and war, for those who are in danger, misery, or distress, for those who minister to human need in your name, for all who share your good, good news, for your whole church on earth, we also pray for those in our very own congregation who are facing illness, heartache, and all kinds of challenges. Today, we lift up the following: Becky Ward, Nancy Wren, John Bryant, Bonnie Waite, Liv Neal, Lori Renner, Valerie Crane's stepmother, who is currently in the ICU, and Sophia Brima, as she returns back to Sierra Leone. What beloved children of God these people are. We also lift up others who either carry something in their hearts or in their minds, that God be with them, no matter what it is they are facing. We pray for your guidance, God, in the coming year. Use us to be a light for the many who are in darkness. God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ.
May we all be transformed into the image of Christ from one degree of glory to another.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to New Philadelphia Meridian Church on this last day of 2023. There are two items of news that you need to be aware of. One is that open door lunch will be served this week on Wednesday, and so volunteers, watch for an email from me. If you are curious about open door and the importance of this ministry to folks who are homebound and think you might want to be involved, please talk to me after this service. We are always in need of volunteers who enjoy making a brief visit and delivering a meal to someone. Also, there is a song that asks the question, what are you doing Christmas Eve? Well, we're going to make it New Year's Eve. because I'll bet some of you may not have plans, and I've got an idea. It's called the Lenten Devotion Guide. There are still 10 scriptures that are looking for a home, for a writer, and I have them right here and would love to give you one after this service. We have a full week to get it done, so consider it. This is going to be a very special and very different devotion guide, and I'd love to have you be a part. Thank you.
So, for the Lenten devotional guide writing party, is there any particular dress code or anything? Or show up as you are. That sounds good to me. Last year, we chose for this year our congregational text, The Lord is My Strength, Habakkuk 3:19. And as I said this, something popped into my mind, an announcement that I would like to add to these announcements, because one of the ways that the Lord is our strength is as we continue to search the scriptures and learn from God through the written word. A reminder that not this coming Wednesday, but the following Wednesday, January 10th, at 11 o'clock in the Friendship Room, every week there will be what is called Bible Recap. And it's a way of going through the Bible in this coming year. So any of you who are free at that time of day, 11 o'clock, it will start not this Wednesday, but the following Wednesday, January 10th, at 11 o'clock in here. Now today, we are going to choose our individual watchwords for 2024, as well as I get the privilege today of digging down through these, and I'm going to ask you to just say a prayer in silence as I reach in, that God would give us a verse that is really especially meaningful for us this year. So, say a prayer. Glory and honor and peace for everyone who does good, the Jew first and also the Greek, for God shows no partiality. Romans 2:10-11. I think as we go through this year, we'll see what God has in mind for us with this verse. Right now, I want to call forward Lydia and Shiloh, who are going to hold these baskets of verses. And then while we sing a song that reminds us that we don't have to fear what tomorrow will bring, because God is our light and God is our lighthouse, we invite you to, if you want to dance forward or just walk forward and pick up your verse for this year. If you would rather not walk forward at the end, please raise your hand and we'll make sure that one is taken to you.
Yeah.
how you want to end the year and how you want to begin the year. And so we now pray these words that were written by Carl Dahl. For the life that you have given, for the love in Christ made known, with these fruits of time and labor and with our gifts that are your own, here we offer, Lord, our praises, heart and mind and strength we bring. Give us grace to love and serve you, living what we pray and sing. In the name of Jesus, amen.
They knew God.
sing that together, because this passage reminds us that since God became a child, we also have that honor, that privilege, that blessing of becoming children of God. Listen to these words. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, in order to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as children. Because you are children, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a child. And if a child, then also an heir through God. Now, this chorus is, behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us, and then that we might be called the children of God. The men and boys are going to start with this part, and I'll sing it once, and then you can sing it with me.
Behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us. Behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us.
Try it.
Behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us. Behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us.
And then the women and the girls are going to sing along with Sandra this part. It goes like this.
That we might be called the children of God.
Sing their part once, then we're going to combine them and sing it all together, and it will be chaos. No, it will be beautiful. Here you go, guys.
Oh, what matter of love the Father has given unto us. Behold, what matter of love the Father has given unto us.
Children of God, that we might be called the children of God, that we might be called the children of God, that we might be called the children of God.
It says, acted out, improv. We are honored this morning to have a cast of characters present here in our congregation. So I would like to invite Mary and Joseph and the child, Jesus, to come forward. And then I would also invite Simeon. Now, Simeon, you have to be kind because he's up in years. And then we have the prophet Anna. I know you're not supposed to give away these secrets, but she's 84 years old. Luke said it, I didn't. Then we also have the Holy Spirit. I'm going to be the narrator. And we're going to hear this story of how Jesus was presented in the temple, and then the reaction of the brother Simeon there. And this is what it says in Luke's account. When the time came for their purification, according to the law of Moses, they brought him, in other words, Mary and Joseph, brought Jesus up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male shall be designated as holy to the Lord, and they offered a sacrifice according to what is stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of two turtle doves or two young pigeons. Take those here on the altar. Now, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying,
"Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all people, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your peoples, Israel."
And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to his mother Mary,
"This child is destined for the falling and rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul also."
There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age. Having lived with her husband 7 years after marriage, then as a widow to the age of 84, she never left the temple, but worshiped there with fasting and prayer night and day. At that moment, she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. When they had finished everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. And the child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. Thank you to our cast of characters. Now, last Sunday, my brother and I chanted the Magnificat. Since then, a few things have happened. Flu, congestion, bronchitis, a lot of other things. And we decided that today might not be the best time for us to try that again with Simeon's words. But I wanted to just take a minute and have you grab one of the blue hymnals. And look on page 251, I believe it is. And you see that a lot of these passages of scripture, Psalms and others, are shown here in chant form. And that's a very nice way of being able to make it interactive and to make sure that the sound and the words carry. But today, instead of chanting, I'm simply going to read the part that's not in bold and have you respond with the words that are in bold print. "Now, Lord, you let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled." "A light to reveal you to the nations. Glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit." Amen. More than 75 years ago, A young man named Hank Williams, some of you will have heard that name, was riding in the back seat of a car that his mother, Lily Williams, was driving. They were on their way home from a show that he had done in Fort Deposit, Alabama, and he was sound asleep in the back seat. But when they got close to Montgomery, Alabama, Lily Williams could see the lights of the airport in the distance, and she announced, "I just saw the light." That meant they were home. And the symbolism and the imagery of that light and that announcement were not lost on Hank Williams. He thought about his own life of wandering in darkness and how he had seen the light of Christ. And he wrote down these words, "I wandered so aimless, life filled with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light." Have you seen the light? I saw the light. I saw the light in three love feasts. It was shining and glowing through band members and bell ringers and flute players and trumpet players and violin players and guitar players and pianists and organists and singers and deaners and coffee carriers and coffee makers and door pullers and ushers and greeters and tech people and preschool children and minor prophets and scripture readers and offering announcers and prayer lifter uppers and candle lighters and families seated together and smiling faces. Our organist, our other organist, Michael Westmoreland, says that he could feel the light when it was time for the opening hymn. Not just because one of the ushers would always turn the lights up for the opening hymn, but no, he said that as he led into that opening hymn, and then the whole congregation stood and started singing, "O Come All Ye Faithful," it was a powerful moment for him. Every time, he said, and he confessed that he was glad that he knew that hymn well enough to play it from memory, because the notes on the page weren't all that clear when seen through teary eyes. But he could see and even feel the light. Now, my moment came each time at the conclusion of the service, when I would stand up there and look over a sea of shining faces and candles, and then we would all raise them up high as we would sing, not "Praise the Lord, I saw the light," but rather "Praise the Lord, God, our salvation. Praise him who retrieved our loss. Sing with awe and love's sensation. Hallelujah, God with us." And then, even though the candles were extinguished, the light would shine through that final chorus of hallelujahs, as we would all go out rejoicing that we had seen the light and we could be the light. Yeah, if you haven't noticed, I kind of like the love feast and the glorious light of the star and the candles and the chrismon tree. Those are precious moments, beautiful memories. But sometimes the light shines in quieter, more subtle ways. But those ways are just as real and can be just as powerful. Some of you have shared some light sightings with me. Some of you spent time in prayer here in the sanctuary and were touched by the light of Christ in special ways. Some of you remembered light sightings from the past, and those memories still seem to be glowing inside you. For those of you who came here to pray and reflect on the Annunciation, the announcement of Jesus' birth to Mary, there seems to be a common theme. That theme is that if we want to see the light and be the light, we have to say yes to what God is calling us to be and what God is calling us to do. We have to be still and know that God is God. We have to take time to listen to God, spend more time in prayer, more time in the Word. I'm glad that as we look forward to this next year, there are plans in place for doing more and more of that, for spending more time in the Word and spending more time in prayer in different ways. But we have to be on the lookout for the light, because even though it's all around us, sometimes we can miss it. In our gospel reading today, the old man, Simeon, was glad that he did not miss it. He saw in the child, Jesus, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to God's people, Israel. The prophet, 84-year-old Anna, saw the light, and she started sharing that light with others. It says she began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. Sometimes the light shows up in unexpected places. One of you saw, and I'll just, by the way, I will say that I'm not going to reveal names today for these stories. I'd just like them to be kind of more general stories that could happen to anyone. But a lot of them you might be able to listen and figure out, I know who that is, and you'll see the light in that way. But this person was actually able to see the light when they were watching the news. I know. But in the midst of a lot of darkness and bad news, you heard a story about some elementary school students and their teacher who were inspired by that secret Santa man who gives away money to strangers every year. So they raised about $8,000 and went out to share it in their community. And those children discovered the joy that comes from sharing hope and love and joy with others. And that news segment ended with this statement: whoever said money can't buy happiness obviously never gave it away. But one of you, after my love feast reflection on no room in the inn, shared this reflection with me. It says, it's no use saying that we are born 2,000 years too late to give room to Christ. Nor will those who live at the end of the world have been born too late. Christ is always with us, always asking for room in our hearts. But now it is with the voice of our contemporaries that he speaks. With the eyes of store clerks, factory workers, and children that he gazes. With the hands of office workers, slum dwellers, and suburban housewives that he gives. It is with the feet of soldiers and tramps that he walks. And with the heart of anyone in need that he longs for shelter. And giving shelter or food to anyone who asks for it or needs it is giving it to Christ. Another one of you reflected back on something that happened at least 30 years ago when you were a Presbyterian. It's the story of a man who was retired from the 82nd Airborne as the command sergeant major, having had a storied military career, including combat service in Vietnam. He had several physical problems, including serious orthopedic issues because of, as it was phrased, too many jumps. And there was moderately serious PTSD and serious gastrointestinal difficulties that made digestion very difficult. You remember that this man asked the session, or the elders, to implement what in James chapter 5 is called the prayer of faith. James asks, is anyone among you in trouble? Let them pray. Is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. Is anyone among you sick? Let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise them up. If they have sinned, they will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. And even this morning, right before church, another example of that, the power of prayer, was shared with me. But this person said that they did exactly that. They all gathered around their brother in Christ. The pastor had the oil, and they all prayed for this man's relief. And he later told some of them that over the next few days, he felt much more at peace. And when he had surgery to deal with the digestive problems, for some reason, the doctor, after performing the planned surgery, felt moved, though he said he had no idea why, to do some additional exploration, and in doing so, found a congenital growth that wasn't malignant, but that had been impeding the man's digestive process for years. The light that is seen in that story is the power of prayer, but also the challenge to elders and church leaders to always be ready to follow the guidance of Scripture and testify to its truth as a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. A friend of mine shared a story about the power of that light, and he said that I could share it here, even though he's not in our congregation here. He said I could share it with you. He says, I was riding a chairlift at Sugar Mountain with a friend in December 2004. We spoke about me not drinking anymore and how I asked Christ to take it out of my life. He, the friend, had a hard time accepting and believing that Jesus could do such a thing. Fast forward to 2011, he says, I was at Samaritan Ministries in Winston-Salem serving meals on a Tuesday evening to the homeless, and the same friend came walking in. I went and sat down with him to find out what happened. He shared his story, but then he looked at me and said, I remember the conversation that we had on the chairlift about Christ, and it took me losing everything to come to him. I felt compelled to take him to my house and get him off the streets, but I heard a whisper from God that said, no, I'm not done with him. Today, that same friend has a great job and is back on his feet. My point is, you never know how you will affect someone's future relationship with Christ. Never be afraid to share your experience and shine God's light for others to see. One of our members has felt the warmth of that light as she has been embraced and surrounded by the care and compassion and love of this congregation, wrapped around her like the trimming on a beeswax candle. She's thankful for that love and that light. One of our staff members has seen the light of the world shining especially bright through another one of our members. She says she is always abuzz, attending to multiple activities and outreach efforts on behalf of the church. She's always smiling and kind-hearted in all she does, and one can easily see God's reflection back to them in her smile and actions. In the past few weeks, she received a scary diagnosis and faced a quickly scheduled surgery. Through all of this, she has remained her normal, cheerful self, undaunted by what might lie ahead. She has been a bright and shining light through the diagnosis, through the surgery, and now through the waiting. So this person says, thank you for being the light of Jesus to me, always, but especially in this season. And not to give it away, but even singing our anthem this morning. And this person goes on to say, Jesus is the light of the world, and nowhere is it reflected more on a large scale than right here at New Philadelphia Moravian Church. All projects, great and small, all ministries, all outreach, all the love and care for each other and for the world beyond reflect what Jesus would do if he were physically in our midst at this moment. If a record would be kept of all the volunteer hours and efforts of just our church folks to be a reflection of Jesus' light to all the world, the totals would be staggering. Well, guess what? A record is kept, and yes, the totals are staggering. It is our joy and honor to be in service with all of you here as we strive each day to be a reflection of Jesus' light to each other, to our community, and to the world. Thank you all for all that each of you do to keep the ministry of the church always going forward, and to the many who often work faithfully behind the scenes to make all things great and small within the church be a true reflection of the light of Jesus. Be encouraged in all that you do, for you may never know the light you have shined in a dark place where someone needed a glimpse of Jesus on that day, in that hour, and in that moment. And finally, we have a story that shows how the beauty of physical light and the beauty of more symbolic or spiritual light can come together in a powerful way. She says, I'll never forget the night of December 4th, 2022. It was the first Sunday of Advent, and following the lighting of our outdoor Christmas tree, About 150 of us assembled in the darkened sanctuary to light, for the first time ever, our chrismon tree. Susie Tickle's name was drawn out of a hat, and she became the one to flip the switch, so to speak. What followed was a collective gasp, and then a minute of absolute silence, because sometimes words do fail. There was no need to comment on its beauty or its astonishing light. There was just the need to be quiet and individually bask in its radiance. This year was the same. The fact that the tree is a year old and we've all seen it in the dark a number of times now doesn't diminish the profundity of the moment when it was lit for the first time in Advent 2023. I hope it will always leave us speechless. But wait, because that quiet is a contrast to the workshops last year when more than three dozen of us gathered to create these symbols of Christ. Over a couple of hours, unsure hands became adept at pulling wire through beads and fabricating crosses and stars and angels. Constant and cheerful chatter accompanied busy hands and the delight of seeing finished products that were more than we could have imagined. How could we have known that these chrismons would reflect light so beautifully and would carry a message so powerful that people would be left speechless? Yes, we know from the Gospels that Jesus is the light of the world. And sometimes it feels good to see physical proof of that. Sometimes it's nice to hold that light in our hands. And it's even nicer than nice when we can share this light, this light, this light beyond these walls. You know, Jesus said, "I am the light of the world," but he also said, "You are the light of the world." And you've heard me many times say that I wish we had a southern translation of the Bible because we would know whether "you" means you or y'all. Well, in Greek, you do know. And Jesus didn't say you individually are the light of the world. No, he said you plural. Y'all are the light of the world. None of us individually can be the light of the world. Jesus has got that covered. But we can be. As the light of Christ shines in us and through us, so that the light will shine in the darkness, and the darkness will never overcome it. Let's give thanks for the light. Light of the world, you shone down, you came down in the midst of our darkness, in the midst of the difficulties that we face in this life, in this world. Your light continues to shine. We thank you for the glorious way that we can see that light reflected in our Christmas Eve and Christmas services and throughout the year. But we thank you even more that that light can shine in us and through us as we go out into your world, the world that you so loved. Help us to be aware of that light, to look for glimpses of that light all around us, and to reflect that light in all that we do. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now we're going to sing a song that you definitely got to be up on your feet. And you may not know it if you don't come to the 11:30 service. You may not know it at the beginning, but it's the kind of song that you may know it by the time we get to the end. And if not, you can at least join in that thought of saying amen, as we know that we are not alone as we face this coming year together. Let's go.
Amen. Whoa, and all the people said amen.
is what we're after. We're all broken, but we're all in this together. God knows we stumble and fall. And he so loved the world, he sent his son to save us all. And all the people said amen. Oh, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. Blessed are the poor in spirit who are torn apart. Blessed are the persecuted and the pure in heart. Blessed are the people hungry for another star. For theirs is their kingdom of God. And all the people said amen. Oh, 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 and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. And all the people said amen. Oh, 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 and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. And all the people said amen.
And as I lift a hand asking God's blessing on us today and throughout the coming year, end of that, I will ask you to do what we just said we're doing, and that is to say amen, and we'll say it with conviction. So please lift a hand asking God's blessing on those who may be in need of that light that we see here and that we can share with them, and show us ways to reflect that light to others. Receive the blessing of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace in the name of Jesus. And all the people said...